Let's look at some matrices with special properties, either in the shape or the nature of the elements or something. Okay, so the first one is a square matrix. When the number of rows of the matrix is the same as the number of columns, then it's a square matrix. I will write R n by n. You see, those two things are the same. That means it's a square matrix, three rows. Now, there is an interesting fact that for any matrix A, M, N, though they don't have to be the same, A transpose is a member of R m by m, and A transpose A is a member of R n by n. They are both square matrices. Now let's look at another definition. If a matrix is symmetric, then what it means is that its transpose is the same as itself. A is equal to A transpose. That is the definition of symmetric matrix. So let me ask you, is it possible for a matrix to be symmetric and not square at the same time? It's not, because if you take the transpose of a rectangular non-square matrix, the shape is already different. So there's no way those two matrices can be the same. They are not even in the same matrix space. They are in different universes. They can never be equal. So all symmetric matrices are square matrices. Then similarly, there is a skew symmetric matrix. It's also called anti-symmetric matrix, when the transpose is the negative of the original one. Again, this applies only for square matrices. There's an important property implied in the definition of a skew symmetric matrix. Let me make it a little simpler. Can you say anything about the elements along the main diagonal? Do they have any special property? They have to be zeros, because they are expected to be the negative of itself. The only number, only real number that is the negative of itself is zero. The elements along the main diagonal are going to be zero in a skew symmetric matrix. Now, if you want to construct a symmetric matrix, one easy way is add A to its own transpose, then you will get a symmetric matrix. Of course, in order to be able to add A to A transpose, A will have to be a square matrix, so that when you take the transpose, it has the same shape. And A minus A transpose is anti-symmetric by the definition of the symmetric and anti-symmetric matrices, and one of the properties of transposition, you can prove these things. So let me take A minus A transpose. I want to know what its transpose is. I just take a transpose of that. We know that transpose of a sum is a sum of transposes. So this becomes A transpose minus A transpose transpose, which is A, which is negative of A minus A transpose. So this basically says that the whole thing here is skew symmetric. Now, we talked about A transpose A and A transpose. Are they symmetric matrices? If I take A transpose A and transpose it, I'll take the second one, transpose it, and that becomes the first one. And take the first one, transpose it, and that becomes the second one of the product. And that is A transpose transpose. So that becomes A transpose A, which is the same as what I started from. So A transpose A is symmetric. So earlier we saw that it was a square matrix, but it's better than that. It's actually a symmetric matrix. By the same argument, you can see that A transpose also is symmetric. Now, A transpose A is called the Gram matrix. Gram matrices are used in machine learning algorithms such as neural networks. If you have a data matrix, which we call A, and if I take A transpose A, that is like the covariance matrix. If you actually take out the mean from all the elements, a member of R, M, N, where M is greater than N, that means A has a shape, is a tall matrix, a few columns, and many more rows. So that's the shape. So that is typical of our data matrices in our data science, because you have a certain variables along which you are making the measurement, and you have multiple measurements, many more measurements than variables. That's typical. If you take A transpose, that is a wide matrix. And if you take A transpose A, then that becomes a square matrix, but a smaller one. A transpose is a huge matrix, but A transpose A is a smaller matrix. Now, on top of that, if you average each column and subtract that average entity from each element, what you're basically doing is taking out the mean of the data in each variable, so that if you plot each one of the variables, it becomes zero center. You're just taking out the mean and moving the mean to zero. In the zero center data set, A transpose A is a covariance matrix. So this will have n variables here, n variables there. So each element will become the covariance, and the diagonal will become the variance. It's interesting because a statistical quantity, which is a bit tedious to compute if you were to do this by hand or in a computer program, becomes basically a matrix multiplication. All right, let's define one more term, diagonal matrix. We already defined what a main diagonal is. If in a matrix, anything other than the main diagonal is zero, all elements other than the main diagonal are zero, then we call that matrix a diagonal matrix. But we are not specifying what the main diagonal elements have to be. They may or may not be zero. So if everything else is zero, then it's already a diagonal matrix. Usually when we talk about diagonal matrices, we are talking about square matrices, typically, so that the diagonal runs from the top left to the bottom right corner. But it's not necessary. Without any ambiguity, we can define diagonal matrix for any shape. So this is kind of like the mathematical definition. For A, in my notation, with a typical element Aij, a member of matrices with m rows and n columns, it is diagonal if the non-diagonal elements Aij when I is not equal to j, those are the non-diagonal elements, are all zero. But we are not saying anything about the diagonal elements. They may also be zero, but so in other words, a matrix with all zeros is a diagonal matrix too. See that a lot of the properties that we are, a lot of the names that we are defining here can be applied to the zero matrix. Zero matrix in the space of matrices is the identity of addition. Now let's define another important matrix called the identity matrix. It's a square matrix with ones along the diagonal, zero everywhere else. And this, we use the symbol I for identity, or IN if you're talking specifically about the number of rows n, number of columns n. So for square matrix with n rows and n columns, if the diagonal elements are 1 and non-diagonal elements are 0 when I is not equal to j, then that matrix is an identity matrix in n dimensions. Now you can see that if you multiply A by identity matrix either on the left or right, then it is A. It doesn't do anything to the to any matrix. So that is an alternative definition of identity matrix. So what's the role of identity matrix? What's the equivalent of identity matrix for numbers? It's like 1. Identity matrix is a square matrix, it's a symmetric matrix, it's also a diagonal matrix. Let's look at the identity matrix a little more closely, because it's an important matrix, a very important matrix. Just like 1 is a very important number in the world of real numbers, the identity matrix is a very important matrix. One thing we can say is that the columns of the identity matrix, the column vectors that are standing side by side in an identity matrix, are in fact unit vectors, and I'll tell you what it means in a second. So they actually specify something like directions in space. Now here I have to be a bit careful. Directions of vectors are actually a concept more appropriate to physics than computer science. The space in which vectors have directions is called the coordinate space. You have x-axis, y-axis and z-axis, and you have a vector somewhere in there, and that has a direction. And if the direction happens to be along the x-axis, and if the length happens to be 1, we will call that the first unit vector, the unit vector along the first direction. Similarly, y and z. So that's the kind of vectors that you have in an identity matrix. Now, that viewpoint is not nascent, not inherent to linear algebra, because linear algebra, even though we are looking at vectors as column vectors, they don't really have to be anything like that at all. In general, in linear algebra, without any representation like that, vectors do not have an existence outside the abstract concepts of vector addition and the scalar multiplication. If you look at the definition of vectors, vectors are those objects, those mathematical entities that obey scalar multiplication and vector addition. So let me give you another set of objects. I have some functions, could be any function of any variable. Let's say it's a function of just one variable, and I'm looking at this function in the region that variable running from 0 to 1. So that's the region, and it's got some shape. Okay, that is one function, and I have another one with some other shape, a different function. If I add these two functions, f1 plus f2, I'll get another function, some other function, maybe f3. If I scale one function, if I scale the first one by something, I'll get some other function, let's say f4. So if I take functions defined between 0 and 1 as a vector, it basically obeys the closure property of scaling and the closure property of addition. So I can actually deal with functions as though they are vectors. And if I want, I can define a dot product between two vectors, which are just functions this time, as something like an integral running from 0 to 1, f1, f2. Let's say its dummy variable is x. If I define it like that, then I have defined the dot product also. Then this is actually a complete set of vectors. And it's just that each vector here, how many points do you have between 0 and 1? You have infinite number of points. So it's like an infinite dimensional function. This way of dealing with vectors in some abstract sense is actually used in physics, in quantum mechanics. Linear algebra is used, and the vectors there are not vectors that stand in a column. In this case, you cannot talk about directions anymore, because for one thing, you have infinitely many of them. Secondly, it doesn't really make sense to talk about the direction of a function. And this is for this reason that if you're dealing with linear algebra in an abstract, theoretical or mathematical sense, it's probably not appropriate to talk about directions. Directions will happen only if you have a finite number of elements. Physics may look far away from computer science, but there is another place which is called Fourier series analysis, Fourier transform, etc., where the same kind of idea is used, and the functions there will turn out to be trigonometric functions with some properties for the dot product, but defined along the same lines. So that's the reason why we shouldn't get too hung up on this notion of directions, because that might lead you to mathematical intuition that may not be right for linear algebra. That might limit the ways in which you might try to solve a problem rather than enhance it. But coming back to a normal three-dimensional space and an identity matrix in that 3x3 matrix space, we can say that the first vector that you see here is the first unit vector, and the second one is a second unit vector, and so on. And if I have a general vector, which I write as x, y, z in a column, then as you can see, you can take the first vector multiplied by x, second one multiplied by y, third one multiplied by z, and add them up, take a linear combination. And that becomes an interesting way of writing that. And this is actually used in classical physics quite a bit. The reason to give you this nomenclature, I hat, j hat, and k hat, as a unit vectors, is because if you look up over the internet some solution or some proof or something, you might see such notations. What is I hat dot j hat? That will be the sum product of the elements, so 1 times 0, 0 times 1, 0 times 0, added up, so that becomes 0. So I dot j, j dot k, k dot I, all those things are just 0. But I dot I is 1 times 1, 0 times 0, 0 times 0, that becomes 1. I dot I is 1. I dot I is the square of the norm of I. So the norm of I is the square root of 1, which is 1. So each vector has size 1, and they're all orthogonal or perpendicular. If you're thinking about vectors with directions, they are perpendicular to each other and they are unit length. Later we'll call them orthonormal basis vectors for R3. Again, I prefer to use the word orthogonal rather than perpendicular, because we defined a different kind of dot product here where perpendicularity makes no sense. The dot product here, if this happens to be 0, that implies F1 is orthogonal to F2 but not perpendicular to F2. But let's look at unit vectors in R2 now, because it's easier to visualize. I have I2, identity matrix in R2x2. So the first one there is the first unit vector. In physics, they might call it I hat. In our context, we might call it Q1 later on. So it's the unit vector along the first direction. So if the first direction happens to be the x direction, then you have that vector running from 0 from the origin to 1. And you have a second one, which is a Q2 or j hat. That is a 0, 1. Suppose you take a general vector y. It's got the first element 1.5, second element 0.75, which can be expressed as a linear combination. 1.5 times 1, 0, so 1.5. in the first element and 0 in the second element, plus 0.75 times 0, 1. So the first element there is 0, the second element is 0.75. Add them up, you get y. So 1.5 times q1, 0.75 times q2, that linear combination is y. Or if you want to talk in physics lingo, it's 1.5 times I hat plus 0.75 times j hat. Going back to the world of matrices, an upper triangular matrix is a matrix with all elements below the main diagonal 0. Again, notice that I'm not saying anything about the main diagonal or the elements above them, other than the fact that all elements below the diagonal are 0. So the notation, the symbol that we use for that is U. Again, Uij, Uij being a representative element. If this is upper triangular, if Uij is equal to 0 for all row indices greater than the column index. So that's the way it looks like. This is the main diagonal and this guy is 0, and everything along the main diagonal and above the main diagonal can be anything, including 0. A 0 matrix is an upper triangular matrix. An identity matrix is an upper triangular matrix. A matrix with all the elements above the main diagonal 0, that is a lower triangular matrix. And main diagonal and everything below it can be anything. Right? So a 0 matrix is upper triangular, lower triangular at the same time, and is diagonal too. An identity matrix is upper triangular, lower triangular, and diagonal. Now, let me go ahead and define one more thing called the inverse of a matrix and singular matrices. A square matrix, a member of R n by n. If you can find some other matrix that multiplies A and gives you identity matrix. That matrix is something that we call the inverse of what I'm looking for. I have the matrix A. I'm looking for something that when multiplied on the right or on the left, it gives me the identity matrix. If I can find such a matrix, I'll call that the inverse. I write it as A to the power minus 1, but read it A inverse. So A inverse in the world of matrices has the same significance as the reciprocal in the world of numbers. I have a number x, multiplying it, I have another number a, a constant. If I write an equation, ax equal to b, everything being number, a and x and b being member of R, just real numbers, then in order to get x, in order to solve this equation, what you will do is just divide both sides by a, which is b by a, which you can also write as a inverse, which is 1 over a, times b. Similarly, if I have a matrix equation in which I have a matrix, b x a vector and b a vector, if I can find another matrix a inverse and multiply on the left, here I have to specify whether it is on the left or right because matrix multiplication in general is not commutative. If I do that, that becomes equal to a inverse b. I'm just multiplying both sides by a inverse. So if I can find a inverse, I can do this and I know that this is I. I also know that I multiplying anything will give me just that anything. So I is like number one. So I get x equal to a inverse b. That is like solve a set of equations. I found the values of my unknowns that will satisfy my set of equations. Remember, a is just a bunch of numbers. B is just a bunch of numbers. So that is the solution. So it's like multiplying a inverse on the left with this vector, which we'll call constants vector later on. Some people tend to write it as A dividing B, but on the left. So you cannot write it as B divided by A because that will be like dividing on the right. Some applications actually implement this notation. So if you define a matrix A and if you define B and write A forward slash B in SageMath, for instance, you will actually get the solution for the set of linear equations that are implied by the matrix A and the constants vector B. Now, what I want to say is that just as in the case of numbers, not all numbers have inverses. I cannot write A inverse in just one special case. I cannot write X is equal to this. This guy, I cannot do this if A is something. What's a number when A is equal to 0? This guy just doesn't work because 1 over 0 is not defined. Similarly, there may be matrices for which you cannot find A inverse. Those matrices are called singular. Of course, 0 matrix is a singular matrix. But it's not the zero matrix, the other matrices also that cannot be inverted. You cannot find A inverse. So A has the same role as a number in some broad sense. And A inverse in that case has the same role as a reciprocal.